All right, so now we're gonna. I just want to discuss a little bit about this person right here. If you don't recognize this, very to me, very ugly individual. Actually, he looks familiar. He looks like those paintings over there in England with a wig, you know, just a different hairstyle, whatever, you know, whatever. But anyways, this is supposed to be Benjamin Franklin. All right, a lot of you, most of you know who that is. So I'm in an Encyclopedia Britannica, well, Britannica.com website. And it says here that Benjamin Franklin, also called Ben Franklin, pseudonym Richard Saunders. Yeah, he had a different name because he had an almanac he used to write, and he would write it under this name, Richard Saunders, before he was, you know, all famous and all that, you know. So it says that 1706, Boston, Mass, and he died in 1790, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. American printer and publisher, author, inventor, and scientist and diplomat. Yadi yadi yadi. Yeah, we already know the story. Yeah, he supposedly invented electricity, right? Like we didn't have electricity in ancient times. Yeah, sure. Benjamin, aka Richard. Now let's get to the real story. Now I just want something that they don't teach us ever in school. So this is on Amazon. I wanted to find my own copy, but this is the best one I found. It's called "Runaway America" by David Walster Streicher. Benjamin Franklin, Slavery and the American Revolution. So, scientist, revolutionary abolitionist, that is the Benjamin Franklin we know and celebrate. To this description, David Walstreicher shows we must add runaway, slave master, and empire builder. All right. This author is saying that not only was he a scientist, revolutionary, and abolitionist, but he was also a slave master and a runaway. A runaway from what? He was a runaway. But runaway America does much more than revise our image of a beloved founding father, finding slavery at the center of Franklin's life. Weistreicher proves it was likewise central to the revolution, America's founding, and the very notion of freedom we associate with both. Franklin was the sole founding father who was once owned by someone else. Franklin was owned by someone else as an indentured servant. As an indentured servant, Franklin fled his master before his term was complete. As a struggling printer, he built a financial empire selling newspapers that not only advertised the goods of slave economy, not to mention slaves themselves, but also ran the notices that led to the recapture of runaway servants. So even though he ran away, he still did it to other people. Perhaps Wallstreicher's greatest achievement in showing that this was not an ironic outcome but a calculated one. America's freedom no less than Franklin's demand that other forego liberty. All right, so I'm in this book. It's called Levelers and Fugitives, Runaway Advertisements, and the Contrasting Political Economies of Mid-18th Century Massachusetts and Pennsylvania. All right. Says in the early 19th century, Pennsylvania and Massachusetts had sharply different political economies and labor systems that were only partly blended with violence. These two political economies are reflected in various stories about Benjamin Franklin, who encountered a markedly different labor system when he moved from Boston to Pennsylvania. 17-year-old Franklin slipped out of Boston. All right. Key. Slipped. All right. We're going to talk about what did they mean by slipped out of Boston. Easily in 1723, by getting a friend to tell a sea captain that he impregnated a girl and wanted to leave quietly. The mariner thought it was more credible that young Franklin was running from a woman and her family than from a master. Say what? Yeah, a master. He was an indentured servant. He was running away. He was a runaway. Few saw white servant runaways in 18th century Boston. White servant runaways. In the year Franklin ran, only six runaways inspired advertisements appeared in the Boston papers. Five masters saw three men of color and three white men. In Boston, Franklin did not arouse suspicion. Upon arriving in the Delaware Valley, though less than 300 miles away, Franklin encountered a watchful society that created and then sought many black and especially white fugitives. Near Burlington, New Jersey, Franklin worried, "I cut so miserably figure that I found my by the questions asked me, I was suspected to be some runaway servant, and in danger of being taken up on that suspicion." A few days later, while eating dinner at the Crooked Billet in Water Street, Philadelphia, "several sly questions were asked me," wrote Franklin. as it seemed to me suspected from my youth and appearance that I might be some runaway. It made sense to interrogate him. Delaware Valley masters in 1723 were looking for 26 white runaways. White runaways. This is history. You can verify this information, right? All whom had substantial bounties connected to them. Franklin might have been John A. Meyer of Jopha, Beeley, Charles Brown, John Cliff, Thomas Coombs, James Henson, Cornelius Lynch, Dennis McGinley, James McCurvey, David Reese, or Richard Skelton. All advertised white men under 22 years of age who fled that year from masters in Pennsylvania. All right, white men, white runaways. All right, we're not talking about Africans here. New Jersey and Delaware. The Boston youth was new on the defensive. If he was held as a runaway, Franklin would have been sold as a servant by the gaoler for a term in order to pay the cost of his detention. He would need to beg his Boston family to come and bail him out. Franklin's migration from Boston to Philadelphia bears out two runaway stories, one well-known and another hidden. In the known narrative, Franklin left a tired, primordial city in social order, Boston that ridiculed, resented, and denied his youthful ambition, to resettle in an upwardly progressing, diversified city, Philadelphia, where self-fashioning was available to all white males, and where consequently Franklin gained wealth and worldwide fame. All right, so you heard that. So that was the story they told us when we were growing up in school of why he left Boston and ended up in Philadelphia. And that was the excuse, that was the reason they told us, right, to make it seem, you know, sugarcoat what really happened. But the real reason, it says here, another story exists, however, as factual and believable, that highlights the power of working people in Boston and their weakness in Philadelphia. Briefly put, when the 17-year-old printer's apprentice and prodigy ran from his work brethren and family in Boston to Philadelphia in 1723, he left a society in which labor and work were carefully and politically empowered, protected, and dignified, for a society in which laborers had far less political and economic power and were therefore often oppressed by property holders, all right? Holders, masters, indentured servants, all right? It's almost like property. Chattel, basically, you're an indentured servant. He was apprentice. He was an indentured servant to his family. We're going to see who it was, all right, to these property holders, all right? And they were oppressed. They were pressed. They were treated like property. Franklin used Pennsylvania's exploitative labor regime and his Boston education to create a new persona. In this version, more complicated than the other, Franklin was less a runaway servant than a hasty, ambitious, and ungrateful adolescent fleeing an unusually organized society of empowered workers, owners, and families who cooperated to block or decelerate his youthful ambitions, just as they had cooperated to educate him and protect his opportunities. So that was his excuse. That's why he ran away. After getting a nearly free education in Boston, and then apprenticing himself to his printer, brother James Franklin, Benjamin Franklin, fell in love with newspaper writing and printing. However, his brother was jealous of his gifts and often beat him. His brother beat his ass. Franklin gained a chance for legal escape when New England magistrates tried to silence his brother for ridiculing them. They placed James in prison and ordained that James Franklin could never again publish a paper called the New England Courant. Cleverly, James kept the name of his paper for his commercial value, but changed the ownership, naming his brother Benjamin Franklin as a sole owner. In order to make the move legitimate, James tore up Franklin's indentures publicly. Franklin's what? He tore what? His indentures, his contracts, his indentured servitude contract. He tore them up because he had to give him the business so he can keep running it, because his brother had him under indenture. At the same time, he wrote a private set of indentures aiming to keep Ben subordinate. So he tore some up so he can make Benjamin Franklin think, yo, look, you're free. This is his little brother, right? They don't have a good relationship. Families were indenturing each other in these times. This is what I'm trying to explain to you too, like fathers and sons, mothers and daughters, all that, all right? Brothers against brothers, they were indenturing themselves, putting their own little brothers in servitude, all right, and mistreating them. So it says that this brother James tore up his indentures, and what he do on the side, he actually made new ones. He made private set of indentures aiming to keep Ben subordinate, just like they were doing with these indentures. That's the whole thing. It became Chattel basically slavery, because they kept people for life. They kept renewing these indentures. They kept to the point where it was only done to the dark colored people, the aboriginals or the dark skinned Europeans, who were there would be classified together with all people of color as Negroes. All right. So it was happening to Ben Franklin. The new indentures proved worthless. If Benjamin left, James could not admit publicly, much less broadcast widely, that the owner of his controversial New England current was a runaway apprentice of that he himself had committed perjury. I took upon me to assert my freedom, Benjamin Franklin noted, presuming that he would not venture to produce new indentures. All right, just real quick, we're in the Encyclopedia Britannica, or Dictionary of Art, Science, and General Literature, 8th edition, volume 10. It says Adam and Charles Black, Edinburgh. And then it says here, Franklin Benjamin, right, one of the most distinguished of Americans alike in science and politics, was born in Boston, New England. All right, so it says that his father was Joshua Franklin. Says that he came in 1682. His dad came from Northamptonshire. Says he was a political he was being persecuted religiously over there, so he was pursuing religious freedom over here. All right, and that's why he supposedly came in 1682, immigrated to New England. For the sake of his religious liberty, which is nonconformist, was denied them at home. I want to show this book. It says The Making of a Patriot, Benjamin Franklin at the Cockpit, Shayla L. Skemp. And right here, it says, we tend to see Franklin as the quintessential example of the American success story, in a large part because his autobiography very deliberately leads us to do so. Looked at one way, his life was the stuff of which the Horatio Alger myth is made. Franklin was the poor boy made good. He was the son of Joshua Franklin, Boston candlemaker, and Obadiah Folger, former indentured servant. His mom, right? Former indentured servant. Reared in poverty and obscurity, he eventually rose through hard work, determination, and native intelligence to a state of affluence and some degree of reputation in the world. All right, his mom, indentured servant. You see, you're starting to see a trend here, right? So remember, the whatever the status of the mom is, they give it to the children. All right, is this what happened? We're in another book. It says Franklin of Philadelphia by Esmond Wright, and it says here about his mother, Franklin says little. Obadiah Folger, Joshua Franklin's second wife, had been born in Nantucket. She was the daughter of Peter Folger, teacher and surveyor, weaver and miller, an interpreter for Indians, a writer of homespun verse. Folger had shown himself in a looking glass for the times, a critic of the persecutions of Baptists and Quakers that marred the story of the Bay Colony. It says Obadiah's mother, Mary Morris, had been an indentured servant whom Peter Folger bought for £20 and later married. All right, so look at this. His grandmother, Benjamin Franklin's grandmother, was an indentured servant, and she was bought by his grandfather for £20. All right, so again, he's coming from a line of indentured servants. Go to this book now. All right, this is actually an official book. I've written memoirs of from Benjamin Franklin himself. All right, so we're going to get into this just so you can see what, get it from the horse's mouth, right? Name of this book is Memoirs of Benjamin Franklin, written by himself and continued by his grandson and others, with his social epistolary, correspondence, philosophical, political, and moral letters and essays, and his diplomatic transactions as agent at London and minister plenipotentiary at Versailles. All right, blah, blah, blah. Volume 1. All right, it's like two volumes. This is from 1834. In this part of the book, he says, my elder brothers were all put in apprentices to different trades. I was put to grammar school at 8 years of age. My father intended to devote me as the thesis of his sons. All right, so all his brothers were indentured apprentices, they say. But they were indentured, basically the same. All right, this part of the book, he's saying how he was basically almost sold, or apprenticed or indentured to his own uncle or his dad's brother. It says, my father determined at last for the cutler's trade and placed me for some days on trial with Samuel, son of my uncle Benjamin, who was bred to that trade in London and had just established himself in Boston. But the sum he exacted as a fee for my apprenticeship displeased my father, and I was taken home again. So his nephew, his brother's son, both of them actually wanted to apprentice him since he was young. They weren't trying to pay the right amount. To his brother, like, no, man, that's too cheap, man. I need some more money. You see, they didn't care. It's all about business. They're selling their own kids and stuff. All right, now, I just want to read up here. It says, in 1717, my brother James returned from England with a press and letters to set up his business in Boston. I liked it much better than my father, but still had a hankering for the sea. To prevent the apprehended effect, so Benjamin Franklin, basically, he wanted to be like in the sea. He wanted to do that. I guess that was his dream, supposedly. And his dad was trying to force him to be other things, to find other labor jobs here and whatever. So it says, to prevent the apprehended effect of such an inclination, my father was impatient to have me bound. All right, you bound, remember bound? Free people of color, they were bound to my brother. All right, so he bound him to his brother. I stood out some time, but at last was persuaded and signed the indentures when I was yet but 12 years old. When he was 12, they made him sign an indenture. He was bound to his brother. He was an indenture. They didn't care. I was to serve an apprentice till I was 21 years of age, from 12 to 21. Only I was to be allowed journeyman's wages during the last year. So he wasn't going to get paid until his last year of being bound, so his 21st birthday. In a little time, I made great progress in the business and became a useful hand to my brother. I know I had access to better books and acquaintance with other apprentice booksellers. All right, so he was his indenture. So again, over here, and last thing says, Benjamin Franklin, in order to avoid the censure of assembly. So they were talking about how they changed the newspaper to his name. Remember, his brother got arrested. So what he did, he contrived and consented that my old indenture should be returned to me with a discharge on the back of it, to show in case of necessity, and in order to secure him the benefit of my service, I should sign new indentures for the remainder of my time, which was to be kept private. So he's saying, oh, he was trying to get me a new indenture, remember? So he was saying, I'll rip these indentures up, but he was trying to privately actually make him stay under indenture. And what did Benjamin Franklin say about that? He says it's a very flimsy scheme. It was a very flimsy scheme. They were doing this to the aboriginals. They were extending your indentures, your servitude. So basically, he ran away. All right. He had an indenture with his brother, and he was a runaway. It's a history you never knew about Benjamin Franklin. All right. He was a runaway. He was a runaway. Benjamin Franklin, you know, was a runaway. Ancestor, descendant of English, well, his mom is through his mom's side, indentured servants that came over here. All right. There's a whole history. They're all, remember, more than two-thirds of all European migrants were indentured servants. This includes all these people who were supposed to be the founding fathers and fighting for their liberty. Why do you think they were fighting for liberty? They're fighting for their liberty.